Good afternoon, and thank you for coming. We are overwhelmed. My name is Thomas Gaetgens, and as director of the Getty Research Institute, it's my privilege to welcome you warmly to this very fascinating event. I would like to especially thank our speakers, some of whom accepted our invitation to come from far away and share their unique knowledge and experience with us this afternoon. We all have witnessed in the last years the terrible acts of vandalism that have occurred in the Near East. The news media, visual technologies have brought the images of the horrific suffering of the population and the disastrous attacks on cities into our homes almost on a daily basis. We also have witnessed the deliberate destruction of cultural monuments and irreplaceable works of art, especially the images of the exploding Bamiyan Buddhas in Afghanistan and the chipping of statues from the earliest cultures in the Museum of Mosul have shocked a worldwide audience. More recently, we saw the invasion of one of the most significant World Heritage Sites, which for thousands of years has been one of the most important trading posts of commodities, goods, scriptures, and works of art, as well as a site of encounter of ideas and knowledge from various cultures, Palmyra. I visited Palmyra 15 years ago, and I can assure you that even during a short visit of 2 days, you can never forget and are forever affected by this magical experience of a location where East and West have converged for centuries. Palmyra, located at the western end of the Silk Road, embodies the history, which was not always friendly, of cultural confluence, of curiosity, of encounters with other ways of life, other languages, faiths, music, literature, and so much more. These encounters make our global present so much richer, although it is challenged right now in such a dangerous and devastating way. It is in this context that I encourage you to read the remarks of our president, Jim Kuno, published on Iris Getty's website in response to the US government's barring entry into our country to citizens for several nations. Let me only quote one phrase which makes clear our mission and our responsibility to protect works of art and monuments all over the world and to support, as Jim states, I quote, scholars, scientists, and other professionals from around the world, including from the targeted nations, in pursuing research and study here with us. It's also why we are proud to welcome people of all faiths, colors, ethnicities, and nationalities into the Getty community. End of quote. Although the images of the explosion of Palmyra traveled around the globe, not everybody knows the site's history. We at the GRI decided, therefore, to develop a virtual exhibition about its history and tell the story, also and especially with our material we hold in our special collections. We cannot cover the entire story of this important location from ancient times until our present day. But we were able, as you will see, and as you have already seen a little bit what you was on the screen, to tell the history of ancient Palmyra through prints and photographs, most of which have not yet been shown to a larger public. The online exhibition, which we are launching today, and which you can see on the GRI's website, was a great experience, but also a major challenge. The conceptual questions regarding the content could be solved because the Getty has such a knowledgeable and experienced staff in all the four programs, the Research Institute, the Museum, the Foundation, and the Conservation Institute. And I can only stress the warm and enthusiastic commitment of our colleagues at the Villa and all over the Getty Hill. However, our initiative was also a technical experiment to which many departments at the GRI, the museum, and the GCI contributed. The product, as you will see, looks fascinating and transfers history and knowledge in an appealing and engaging way. But you would probably not believe in how many meetings the contributors have deliberated on how to move things around, correct, improve the presentation. I would like to especially thank a few colleagues who stand at the very beginning of this initiative. Francis Turpak, curator of photography at the GRI, and Peter Bonfito, research associate at the Scholars Program at the GRI, as well as Liz McDermott, head of web and new media at the GRI. They have worked very hard for almost two years, to realize this online exhibition, which in fact asks for just as much time, labor, and commitment as a non-virtual exhibition. However, I should also thank many more of our colleagues for their work in making our first online exhibition, specifically Jack Ladden, head of web and new media development, Paul Carlson, who built the exhibition site, Masato Nakada, and Karen To Nakada, who are responsible for the amazing design, as well as Uma Nair, project manager, Andrew Kersey, editor, Jane Friedman, project associate, and of course, Su Kang, who organized today's event. Our colleague, Claire Lyons, curator of antiquities at the Getty Museum, will introduce our panelists today. Claire is an archaeologist training who has served as vice president for professional responsibilities of the Archaeological Institute of America. She is currently a member of the editorial board of the International Journal of Cultural Property. In addition to her scholarly publications and the many curatorial projects, she has lectured and written widely on cultural heritage issues. Please join me in welcoming Claire Lyons.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Thomas, for the privilege of introducing four distinguished experts on Syrian cultural heritage. Our panelists are going to share their experiences in grappling with the dire situation of ancient sites and historic city centers, which can't and mustn't be separated from the violence that puts Syria's communities and her people in enormous jeopardy. Circumstances on the ground change quickly, with fresh destruction and pillage taking place against the backdrop of an ongoing humanitarian crisis. The urgency of such losses has chilling implications for the concept of culture wars. For us, a political divide, but for others, a devastating reality. Today, however, we will also hear about some responses from the perspectives of archaeology and history, preservation and advanced technologies, and diplomacy and geopolitics. After their presentations, our guests will gather here on stage for an open dialogue with you. To make certain that there is ample time, I'd like to suggest that you hold your questions after each of the individual presentations, which are going to be about 40 minutes each, and then to address them to the panel discussion as a whole. And just a quick note, as you're already used to, please silence your cell phones. Recording, photography, and filming is not permitted, and that's because we, as you can see at the top, we're doing that for you, and a complete record of today's panel will be available on the Getty website in the fullness of time. So, it is therefore now my pleasure to introduce first Professors Giorgio and Marilyn Buccellati, who will discuss archaeology as a moral presence in war-torn Syria. Giorgio Buccellati was the founding director and emeritus professor at UCLA's Coatesson Institute of Archaeology, and is now director of the International Institute for Mesopotamian Area Studies. Together with Marilyn Kelly-Buccellati, he has investigated archaeological sites across Syria and the region. Their decades of field research resulted in the groundbreaking identification of Tel Mozan in northern Syria as the site of ancient Urkesh. And in 2011, the excavation earned the AIA's award for best practices in site preservation. Dr. Buccellati has published extensively on the political institutions, statehood, religion, languages, and ethnic integration in ancient Syro-Mesopotamia during the third and second millennia BCE. They're going to speak in sequence, so let me also now take a moment to introduce Marilyn Kelly Buccellati, who is Professor Emerita in the Department of Art at California State University, Director of the Mozan-Urkesh Archaeological Project, and visiting professor at the Coatesson Institute of Archaeology. In addition to her many publications from Mozan, her research centers on the connections between the cultures of Syro-Mesopotamia, Eastern Anatolia, and the Caucasus. She specializes in ritual, ceramics, and seal iconography, a breadth of topics shaped by her prior fieldwork at Korojutepe in Turkey, Nippur in Iraq, and the sites of Turka and Kreia in southeastern Syria. So please welcome first Giorgio, then Marilyn. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Claire and Thomas. We'll take our talk will serve as an introduction, in effect, to the meeting today, and we'll especially emphasize the subtitle, as it were, Syria's cultural heritage in conflict. The first slide is intentionally black to remind us of the dark clouds that are covering Syria. And this image that we have already seen, which is so also emblematic of what Syria was before, Palmyra was before the dark clouds, has been particularly brought to attention because of the assassination, really brutal assassination of Khaled al-Assad, the former director of Palmyra. Marilyn and I were in Palmyra 51 years ago, in August of 1966, about the same time as Thomas, I think. But we were there for a month in August, and we lived for during that month in the precinct of the temple, the little circle at the top where there was a guest house of the Department of Antiquities. And therefore, the destruction of the temple has taken on a special personal ring for us. Khaled had just started himself his career as director of antiquities there. We had just started our own career. And so we became close friends. But I would like now to also mention, in addition to his name, the names of nine other functionaries of the Department of Antiquities that have been killed in the line of duty. And I will just read as a sign of homage to their sacrifice. Their names in chronological order. So Khaled Abdul Razak al-Issa, Yahya Ibrahim, Yahya Abdul Fattah al-Mukdam, all of them from Basra. Huda al-Hamoud from Idlib. Abdullah Ehmayed al-Khalaf from Dur Europos, near the Rezor. Mohammed Ahmed al-Mahmoud from the Damascus province. Abdullah al-Hamid from the Rezor. Qasim Abdullah Yahya, in Damascus. He was the associate director of laboratories and was killed by a bomb in his office in the Damascus Citadel. And since we're going in chronological order, Khaled al-Assad, who was in Palmyra, Ismail Muhammad Ali from Deir ez-Zor. Their sacrifice was really indicative of the commitment that it wasn't casual. It was not that they looked for it, but there was a great deal of awareness of what the danger was and of their commitment to their duty. I will, as I said before, open a window, as it were, on what, to give you a chance to reflect on what cultural heritage is, a term that is so much in fashion, but what was it? And the window will be our own work, which is in itself a small project. It's perhaps a large site, an important site, but in comparison to everything else that's happening in Syria, certainly a small project. But it will help us to focus on what archaeology is called upon doing in times of crisis and beyond. A few words about the nature of the site. It is on the northern, in the northeastern part of Syria, and it's one of the earliest cities in history because it really started out around the beginning of the fourth millennium. This is the building we found just the year that we ended the excavations before the war. It's a temple that was found immediately below the surface at the top of the tell, which indicates, and there is a potential reconstruction just from the small corner that we found. It's dated to around 3,500. And it is indicative, therefore, of the great potential of the site also for these earlier periods. The main period, however, is the third millennium. It is a large temple with a monumental staircase. This dates to about 2,500, 2,300 BC. It's a large precinct, and it is connected with a large palace and a necromantic shaft next to it. The necromantic shaft is particularly important because it's indicative of a very specific cultic cult of the dead and of the gods of the netherworld, of the Hurrian religion. And next to it, the royal palace, dated to about 2,300, in which we found, among other things, written texts that gave us the name of the site of the ancient city. I have this picture just to show you the how difficult it is to find these very small pieces of clay on which there is inscribed in cuneiform, as I said, the name of the city, of the king, of the queen, and of members of the household. And also we had a number of other objects, including this plaque in stone that represents Gilgamesh and Enkidu. Well, what does this have to do with our topic today, you may be asking yourselves. Well, it has to do with the subtitle, as I said at the beginning, that is the question of cultural heritage. And it was, in a way, a challenge for us, for Mary and for me, to come and talk to you about this site, which in and of itself has not been bombed, is not being destroyed by either bombs or vandalism. But that's precisely the point that we want to make, to show how archaeology, seen in terms of its social relevance, can have a strong impact on society, particularly when it's put to the test in the eye of the storm, as we entitled the talk, during a period of crisis like the war. There are two main reasons why this weight matters. One, psychological. It contributes to a great sense of identity and of pride in values, in proper values. And on the practical level, the second reason, it also provides economic sustainability to the local people, which has two important effects, because in seen in this light, archaeology becomes a bulwark against two dangers: the urge to leave the country, the migrants, who have really, in and of themselves, no particular desire of leaving their country, and if helped, they would much rather stay where they are. And second, perhaps less immediately apparent, but very important, I think, it's a bulwark against the pseudo values of fundamentalists, in particular the ones of Al-Qaeda or the so-called Islamic State. So our story, in effect, wants to show you how archaeology seen in this light can provide the best bulwark precisely against all of the problems, the dangers that we otherwise know. So we come to Mozan, which is the modern name of the ancient city of Urkesh today. And I will speak about what I call the dignity of the finds. The finds have, even the smallest find, the small pieces of clay that turns out eventually to have writing, but even the ones who don't turn out to have writing, have a dignity of their own that needs to be cared for, nurtured. So there has to be a sense of responsibility, and that's where conservation comes in. Conservation is not just a post hoc thing that is applied from the outside, but it's something that should be built into the very process of excavation. If by doing so, that's the point that I'm trying to bring out, which is relevant, I think, to us today. By doing so, we convey to the local people the value that we attribute to these finds. And it's not just the spectacular finds, but everything that is being excavated is important. So I will speak to you then about the conservation, and I will show you the climate, which, as you can see, it's very changing. It's snowing in the winter and very hot in the summer. And this is how the temple looks when it rains, the temple staircase. And this is how the palace looks when it snows. So we decided from very early on in the stage to protect them with a system of trellises that are then covered with a very simple burlap. This is one of the points also that we will be stressing, the simplicity of the approach that relies entirely on local resources and on maintenance from the beginning. The sides of the of these localized protective structures are can be opened so that one can see the walls underneath, some of which stand to about 3 meters in height, they're mud brick, and after 30 years of excavation, they're still in pristine state. Or in pristine state meaning also a wall that was crumbled in antiquity like this one. So we end up having as if two sites in one with the covers, one sees the architectural volumes, and when the covers are removed, you see the ruins as they have been excavated. We have a long-standing association with the GCI, and here is a picture of Neville and Martha, who Neville Agnew and Martha Dimas, who came to visit us in 2004. I had started this sort of protection of the site as a common sense approach, and I wanted to have sort of approval, as it were, of the professionals. And Neville and Martha came, as you saw at night. They came for a couple of days, and we immediately went to the site. And here we are discussing some of the details. And they gave their approval. And they suggested that we keep, they had already done this before, that we keep a record. And I'll show you now a sequence of images which are on our website of one wall. There are about 400 meters, linear meters of wall. This is the one of the faces of the wall with the drawing. And this, we scroll through the various years down to 2016. So we have a complete coverage of photographic coverage for the last 15 years. And the same for the humidity and temperature. Now, the all of this just to tell you how we had set up the thing, and we will now look at how it has survived during the 6 years of war. See, the insistence on values, that is sharing with them the reason for doing this, the simplicity of the, there was nothing really fanciful. You see in the presentation by our colleagues later, a much higher level, state-of-the-art kind of work. We are at the opposite end. It's a very low level of technology, but a very effective one. So extreme simplicity, local resources, and maintenance are really the keywords. The last time we went was in December of 2011, so a few months after the war had started. And we did our work, and then we remained in contact with them. We also set up ways of paying them, expecting that the war might last, although we didn't expect it would last so long. And here, as we have a very complete coverage of these 6 years now with our local people protecting the site, with, again, the simplest possible approaches. Here they are patching our curtains. I call it the arte povera of conservation, the poor art. And we are proud of it rather than feeling sort of having an inferiority complex. And so you see the patches, and then when the patches are not enough, we replace them with walls, with new burlap, different colors, but it doesn't matter because the walls are in fact protected. You see from the dates how this works. There is a certain aesthetic value, but certainly we are not aiming at giving a great aesthetic satisfaction. But here, look, it's April of last year, and the palace is still the way it was, not only in 2011, but also when it was first excavated in the 80s. We also wanted to send the message that even though the war was upon us, we were there for the long haul. Over the shaft, the necromantic shaft I showed you before, the burlap had completely disintegrated, and so they asked us, because we were in continuous contact with our people there, should we cover them again with burlap? And we said no. I said, let's, as a signal, both to make it more durable and as a signal of our commitment, let's do it in metal. Again, nothing spectacular about this, but what is spectacular is that it works. Now, we were never overrun by the so-called Islamic State, but we are very near, about 60 kilometers from the border, let's say. And this was from the map was from the New York Times on the October 22nd, and on the same date, here are our people protecting, in this case, the staircase, because besides the mud brick, there is also the staircase that has to be protected, because the problem is that if the joints are, the mortar of the joints melts, then the stones come apart. And this is the kind of documentation we get. It's a folder on Dropbox with the images. This is the way in which they indicate which wall it is. Each wall has a number, but it's easier for them to send us a picture of the plan with the ballpoint pen showing which wall we are talking about. And there are descriptions for each image. We have about 10,000 pictures that we received in the last 6 years. Again, the highest technology we use is just the internet and the transfer of images like this. This is the way in which they protected the top of the wall. And the human touch is always very significant. I told Yadid, this is the man who sends us these pictures online. I told Yadin, who is a photographer, about the images. He said the image is ready, but cannot bring me the pictures because the road cut off by snow. He said, when opening the way, will bring me, thank you, Kamiran. Sort of Google translation of Kurdish, but which is perfectly understandable. And then this, which dates back to 2012, but it's always very dear to our heart. They report their hours on a daily basis. And for 1 week, there was 0 hours. I marry my wedding. And this one then takes us to the meat of the whole thing. This has an impact, and that's what Marilyn will talk to you about.
We started from the beginning talking, having discussions, and talking to our workmen who are, of course, the local stakeholders. And this is one of the discussions after work with the workmen. Then the bottom one is me presenting the ceramics. We were, of course, always telling them that we want to save everything, as Giorgio indicated. And of course, the ceramics are so many of them that it requires a lot of work. So try always to convince them, as Giorgio said, the dignity of the objects, to always trying to talk to them about how important the ceramics are. And we also had presentations for the local dignitaries in the various towns around, especially at the end of the season, where all of our workers would also come. And they would bring their children. And you see this young girl, we're gonna hear about her in a few more minutes too, but she was taken there by her father. This is a brother who took his little sister to see the excavations. So it filtered down in many, many levels of the society. We also made a great effort, besides the conservation, made a great effort at presentation of the site. Now, a great effort also means that we wanted to have it, again, simple, constructed with local materials, and something that we could always update ourselves. So this is one of the panoramas that we constructed out of metal. And the pages are only printed on our computers at the site. We also had what we consider called music stands, that they could be explanations, short explanations, right next to the part of the excavation that was being explained. So you could read these or you didn't have to read these, but the information was available if you wanted it. We also made an effort to include the local school children, and this is the one time that they came to visit us. And we would give them in-depth presentations of what was going on and what we were actually accomplishing at the site. And to continue this, we have made a booklet of the important objects and stratigraphy at the site. And the importance of this is, it's the first site booklet that has the three languages, English, Arabic, and Kurdish, because we are in an important Kurdish area of Syria. We also had visitors, some locals, Los Angeles visitors too, and you probably will recognize this gentleman who came to visit us. We had visitors from other archaeological teams, and this is another aspect of the site presentation. With our back dirt, we sometimes built these hills so that you could have an overview of the excavation. And here, the three circles show you on the left. It was a student at UCLA when he finished and went back to Saudi Arabia, and he's now the director of the museum. And the next is a student from Finland who was in Chinese archaeology, and through the Coatsen there is a program for sending students in various countries to excavate. And then we have Jonah Roos there on the right with one of her, from the Metropolitan, with one of her assistants who was at that point a member of our staff. And we've also reached out to have a series of exhibits on our excavation and our material. And the first one that I want to talk about is one that the U.S. Embassy in Damascus asked us to prepare. So in 2010, 2011, this is a poster exhibit that was exhibited in the garden of the ambassador's house in Damascus for the 4th of July, which is always a very big party for Independence Day. And they did a wonderful job putting it up. But it was only for that day. But the idea was that it would go to the National Museum in Damascus, and indeed it did go. It opened in the National Museum, and this is a picture of the Deputy Chief of Mission with the Syrian Minister of Culture at the opening on the 1st of March, 2010. And this is the SANA website, which shows the two flags about at the opening. And I think it's probably the last time that those two flags have been flying together. We also had a very big exhibit of in the meeting at Rimini. Most people in this country don't know about these cultural fairs in Europe, and this is a very big, large one that happens every August for 1 week in the city of Rimini in central Italy. So we had this exhibit in 2014, and in 1 week, over 20,000 people went to this exhibit. Here you can see a few images from the exhibit. As a part of the exhibit, we invited the directors of antiquities of several museums in Syria to come and give a presentation. This is the circle is the director of the Idlib Museum. Then we have the director of the Aleppo Museum. And then the director of antiquities for our area, that is from the city of Qamishli. Now, this is Dr. Suleiman. He was extremely impressed by the nature of the exhibit and, of course, by the number of people who went. So he suggested to make an exhibit in Qamishli. And so this is a map that you saw. Qamishli is only 60 kilometers from the so-called Islamic State. But he organized, with our help, he organized an exhibit in Qamishli, which was extremely popular and very well attended. All kinds of people who came, men, women, children, families. So it was extremely an important exhibit. And the exhibit traveled. The exhibit went to small communities in the area. So this is Amuda, which is the small town near our excavation in February 2015. Again, great enthusiasm on the part of the local people to see this exhibit. This slide is intentionally black. Also because the so-called Islamic State wants to destroy this cultural heritage, this cultural identity. And so this is the famous photo of them driving these Toyotas northward into Syria. And at the same time, we see these little cars taking the posters from Qamishli to these various towns in the area, and how happy they are and proud they are to have this exhibit in their small town. So this is, of course, the destruction of all of these statues in Mosul, and at the same time, the joy that these young people have in mounting an exhibit in their town. We also had suggested before the war to create a very large eco-archaeological park, and the 22 villages, 54 square kilometers. And we had started talking to this, to the government, and also to the local people about the establishment of this park. Two rooms were made available for work of the local women, because what we wanted to have was a specific craft center in every village, all of the 22 villages, that would be combined also with this ancient craft. And so the people, the local people, made one of them into a little photographic exhibit for themselves. So these are all their pictures. We didn't send them any of these. And in the other building, the women would work on producing these craft items. And here you see them. And they made these wonderful dolls, not Barbie dolls by any means, but very wonderful local dolls. They even made themselves a logo that you can see there on the lower left. Detail. Now, the women who had started making these crafts, they either got married or they moved away with their family. So there were fewer and fewer of them left making these local crafts. So we suggested to them that maybe there could be a class to teach the younger women in these villages how to make these crafts. And indeed, it happened that there is an ongoing class now, and a kind of ongoing work group of these women. And the first picture they sent us, we said, well, we'd like to have some pictures. The first picture they sent us was this one, which was pretty dark. But this is the second one. And you see, they don't want their faces photographed. And they didn't want our photographer to go, because he is a man. They took it with one of their cell phones, and it very creatively done, without showing their work, but without showing their faces. This is some of their work. And they're very proud of the fact that they now sell these things that they're making in the local cities. So they have an economic support for their family, which is, of course, very important in this time of crisis, and very, very high prices for everything in Syria. The value of research is also present. You saw this slide. In December 2011, we went to set up a process that would continue during the war of working on the ceramics that had not been analyzed. And this man carrying the box was my chief assistant for the analysis of the ceramics. And he had worked for more than 10 years in analyzing with me the ceramics from the site. So so he continued. We took the ceramics slowly to his house so he could work in his courtyard. And this is him. So proud of the fact of his work, and he found on the site this jar, so he's showing us this jar that he found. But more importantly, he would send us all of these files, which were later, they were hand-done, but later turned into Excel files there in the village, and they would send us these Excel files based on his work, because he had done it for so long, and he had all of the paperwork that he would need to do it. So the students from the university asked him to give them a seminar on the Mozan ceramics. And so even again, the same map, even though 60 kilometers north of the border with ISIS, he conducted this seminar in October 2016. And these are some of his students, and that's the whole group of students that he gave the seminar to. And they even had a certificate for the completion of the seminar. And these photographs are the little girl that you saw visiting the site with her father. Well, she has now grown up. And she is one of the students in this class. And that's her certificate of the completion of it. So here is the little girl, but we don't have a picture of her. People still go to the site. Giorgio mentioned the fact that it hasn't been destroyed. It's been very well preserved, and people are proud of that fact. So visitors to Mozan during the war, this is visitors 2015, and these are the university students from Qamishli who went there in April 2016 with Dr. Suleiman. You saw him in the Rimini and also with the exhibit. These are the students with their selfies. You know, students are just left to have their picture taken. So these are a series of selfies. But you can see in the background that the site really looks quite good. And of course, as Giorgio pointed out, we have 10,000 pictures from all of these years. So we know that the site is in very good shape. The women students as well as men. And here they are sitting on the steps of the temple, leading up to the temple, and waving to us. And so they are emblematic of our whole effort that we have been making. This is a telling tale of the impact that archaeology can have on contemporary history. Ours is only one of two projects that have remained continuously active in Syria out of more than 100 that were there in 2010. Our project is not active as excavation, but as a real presence, a presence that is nourished precisely by what archaeology can offer to the consciousness of the local people. That is, the consciousness of the local people for the way in which conservation of the site speaks to our commitment to integrate the local sensitivities, for the way in which the educational activity is developed in a mutual exchange, for the way in which we have integrated the local women in economically sustainable activities. And as I pointed out, this is very important for the families. For the way in which local people are encouraged and enabled to remain instead of migrating. As Giorgio pointed out, they don't want to migrate. And especially, perhaps, for the way in which the so-called Islamic State is robbed of potential recruits. Archaeology speaks also to the deeper value of culture in general, in a world that seems to be falling apart. The unearthed civilizations are not mute or inert. They have a profound impact even on those who are seemingly less well prepared. The awareness of the past life of the territory plays a large role in shaping the identity of anyone who now lives in that territory. In the region of ancient Urkesh, Syrians from many different origins find a commonality through this shared past that gives them a sense of pride. The more felt this pride, the more it is in danger. It is what a Syrian colleague of the opposition said at the conclusion of a recent UNESCO meeting we attended in Berlin. He said, "Archaeology can bring us together where the political divide seems all the greater." We have seen this time and time again in our experience in Syria. A broken past is broken no longer, once mended by the archaeologists who care. Almost like a submerged archetype that defines the reality of today. Thank you.